Hello from Copenhagen, Denmark. In the next hour, I'm going to share practices, tools, recommendations in order to decide better in legal and compliance. When we are deciding which is a good contract or how to implement compliance controls, we have a very tangible need for better tools and better ideas to deal with risk management. So in this journey today, we're going to cover some of those ideas that they are collected from working more than 25 years in risk management, in leading organizations, helping to implement tools in the business, in the C-level, in order to decide better. And this advisory role that we are always focusing from legal and compliance needs to be supported by proper risk management. So thank you for joining, and let's start with this journey. In order for you to implement changes, you need to explain them. You need to understand the what it needs to be changed, what are the needs, and also why you need to improve the techniques in order to quantify legal and compliance risks. But knowing the what means nothing. You need to understand the how. How do you finally gonna address those needs? How are you going to be dealing with the tool, the practices, the methodology, the standard operating procedures that finally will allow to comply with the needs? And then knowing the what and knowing the how is also nothing. It's not really triggering changes. You need to understand the why, how these new ideas, new tools, new methodologies, new needs are finally protecting your career, are finally helping you to advance and to be a better professional, to be focused on good standards, to be able to challenge the decision and to help in the decision when it comes to the assumptions, when we need to finally budget for controls, or we need to craft a contract, or we need to decide better. And then finally, I'm gonna share a tool that is gonna help you to understand what is under the hood, what is the underlying calculation for some of these ideas, so you can be in full control and you can advance from this session to finally apply best tools into your own decision making, into your own career, your own organization. So this is a journey. This is the way that we are supporting the maturity of the decision making in the organization from the legal and compliance aspect. And it requires also to understand how we can use best practices in risk management, because at the end of the day, protecting an organization means to have an impact on the decision making. Let's start for the what. Why we need to change? Why we need to use better methodologies in risk management? And I want to be very clear. I want to be very, very direct in the need, because you will need also to be very direct in the way that you are explaining these ideas across your organizations, across the decision makers, across the C-level. If you are replacing the use of good risk data, if you are replacing the use of scientific methodologies by using heat maps, 5-to-5 matrices, these green to red cells, you are committing a professional malpractice. You should protect your organization with good methodologies, with good data, and also in that direction, you are protecting your own career, your own responsibilities as a legal advisor, your own responsibilities as a compliance manager. Why? Why these methodologies as risk matrices, qualitative scales, the scoring systems that they are based on adjectives? Why heat maps that they are so popular in our community are deemed as ineffective? There are a lot of studies coming from more than 10 years ago that they are highlighting that these qualitative assessments, that these heat maps, these 5-to-5 grills have a strong, severe technical limitations. It means that you are unable to decide what is better. You are unable to allocate resources in order to decide which are the compliance controls that you need to implement. You cannot decide which are the liabilities and the compensation that finally are going to be protecting the organization. You are unable to decide which is the right amount of coverage in insurance policy. Because what is a red risk? What is a high or catastrophic event? There may be a different definition according to you ask for, too. It may be different views. And finally, there will be a lot of arguments without really understanding different scenarios, without really understanding what are the assumptions for planning. And finally, you cannot aggregate those risks. You cannot consolidate. You cannot tell that a level 2 risk, it's the aggregation of 2 level 1 risks or whatever that you want to aggregate. So because of the compression in the different limits, when we are saying that this is from 0 to 10% of occurrence a year, or this is between $10,000 to $100,000. The compression, the limits, are not producing consistent results. So there are plenty of proven pieces of evidence that in science are asking to use good risk data and to use methodologies that they have been around for a long, long time, and they can help much better into the decision making. They can be used by you in the legal department, by you as a legal consultant, by you as a compliance officer, even a data protection officer. There are much better tools than using analysis based on opinions, based on adjectives. So we know that. We know that these methodologies that they are extremely popular are ineffective. But on the other hand, we are asked to produce a much better risk assessment across our organizations. And this is a complete game changer. There are more regulations that they are based on accountability principles, so they are not waiting for the organization to violate, to breach a requirement, but they are asking the organization to apply reasonable controls, reasonable technical measures, reasonable organizational measures, in order to prevent those breaches to happen. And in order to be reasonable in the actions, in the plans, in the compliance program that we are applying, in the privacy program that we are applying, we need to produce a much better risk assessment. When we are talking about anti-money laundering, when we are talking about criminal law, when we are talking about privacy, there are more and more and more requests for the organizations to support what they are doing and, more important, what they are not doing. So it's extremely important that legal and compliance professionals are more eager to use better methodologies, better tools. Where we are now, we know, for instance, that privacy law, for instance, GDPR, the gold standard in privacy in Europe, that is a global regulation, because pretty much what any global company needs to comply with GDPR, as long as they are dealing with personal data for residents in the European Union, is asking for the implementation of appropriate technical and organizational measures. So they are asking for the proper data protection controls. They are asking for the proper budget to have a privacy function and to have a privacy program. In order to sustain, in order to demonstrate compliance with this regulation, you need to justify what is appropriate and what is not. So here means that you need to be very good in the way that you are justifying the controls according to the risks that the organization is facing. And then the next question is, how you in the legal and compliance department are giving a priority, assigning a priority for the compliance controls from the investment in cybersecurity, from the liabilities that you are negotiating in contracts with data processors, for instance, to be appropriate or not. Justifying whether a control is appropriate based on this is a green risk, this is a red green, this is catastrophic or not, is not producing your defense. It's not helping your organization to be finally exonerated if there is a breach here. You cannot demonstrate with these opinions whether you are. Then we get other pieces of regulations covering corporate criminal laws, coming from Italy and Spain and then going to Latin America and other countries in Europe and worldwide. There are more and more requests for the organizations to implement compliance programs. And those compliance programs should be able to reduce the chances that the organization have, the probabilities, to commit a criminal offense that can create a responsibility on behalf to the organization. So we are talking here about criminal laws. We are talking here about a very serious offense. We are talking here about a lot of investment that you need to give a priority, whether it's important for you to deal with whistleblowing, whether you need to look for training, whether you need to look for insider trading, whether you need to look for corruption or fraud. There are a lot of decisions in the way that you need to articulate your program in order to prevent the company to commit, to facilitate an offense. So, talking about colorful maps is not helping in order to show evidence of good compliance. There are a lot of requests coming in this direction, and the effectiveness for the compliance and legal functions to change the decision making, to improve the way that the companies are more sustainable in the way that they decide, and they can prevent fraud, corruption, insider trading, and many other offenses and breaches to happen. And then also, if we go to the US and we are talking about companies that they are listed in the New York Exchange, there is a new guidelines that is always evolving, it periodically is evolving, and they are asking US prosecutors to evaluate how companies are dealing with the compliance risks, how these compliance risks are identified, how these compliance risks are finally quantified, they are given a priority, and then finally, they have preventive and corrective actions in order to be able to justify the level of controls and investment that the organization is doing. It needs to address how the risk profile, different risks can be aggregated according to different pieces of regulations. And explaining that you are deciding to do not address, for instance, corruption because it's a green risk, is not going to impress any US prosecutor. So definitely, when these requirements are being applied by leading companies in countries that they are advanced, all the companies, medium-sized, small-sized, worldwide, they need to adjust in order to provide some comfort, some credibility to be a supplier for these companies. If you also need to address needs for this organization, you will need to have better tools in order to justify what you are doing and what you are not doing. And then there are tools, there are alternatives to the heat maps. We, in compliance, are using decision trees analysis. These analyses are extremely helpful when we need to define which is the best course of action, which is the best decision making, and we identify different alternatives. Should I litigate or not? Should I exercise this clause or not? And then you can see the consequences, and you can add for each of those consequences, which are the chances to have other consequences in the chain, and finally, what will be the impact? How much money will you lose, or how much money will you gain? We are also using a lot of sensitivity analysis. These methodologies are based on the way that we can identify different factors, and we can group the functions and to see the event, to mitigate, to control, to do not be exposed, to manage the factors that are more promising in the way that they can produce the better results. If you are using a colorful map, you cannot identify which are the factors that you need to address. So in this approach, we are using also tornado charts, and we can see and we can give a priority for the triggers, the sources, the factors for the compliance and legal risk to happen. And finally, we are also using Monte Carlo simulations. This method is very effective in the way that we can assess different risks for a whole bunch of scenarios. We're going to go deeper into this methodology during the session. If you are using data-driven methodologies, if you are using a methodology that is scientifically based, your chances to produce a better evidence for corporate defense are much better. But not only that, you can really understand which is the best strategy in order to protect your organization, in order to maximize the chances for success. In risk management, we are dealing with the success of the objective. Which are we want? Do we want to target? Which is the outcome? Which is the capability of the organization to be exposed to risk? And finally, assume as much risk that we decide that is paying off, that we think that is worthy. And it has to be an informed decision. And it's a decision that is finally embedded into a lot of processes. These methodologies are not only used when we need to address with privacy or criminal law. They are used in the very decision-making for the organizations. For instance, when you need to negotiate contractual clauses and provisions, which are the, for instance, compensations that will make sense, whether you need to focus on some operations in order to avoid the breaches, when we need to establish reserves for penalties and liabilities, when we need to calculate prices and concession bids, the price that we are bidding, that we are offering, is paying off the legal and compliance risk that the organization is assuming. How many organizations have very, very, very deep problems because of the lack of evaluation of the reserves? Also, you need to know, how do you want to invest in controls? How much do you want to invest in controls? Which are the controls and which is the extension of the control? Whether there are compliance controls, controls to finally avoid a breach, avoid a fraud, avoid having an integrity risk, controls related to securing data, personal data, privacy, controls to ensure that there is not any fraud or corruption. It requires you to understand which is the extent of the controls, how many attributes can you deploy, how deep can you really invest, and whether you need to invest on prevention or you need to invest in finally addressing when the risks are materialized in order to diminish the impact. So you are dealing with crisis protocols, you are dealing with the consequences of those breaches. Also, you need to decide insurance coverage, warranties, liabilities, cyber insurance, even in that there is a role in the legal terms when we are talking about penalties. We also use these methodologies in order to dispute arguments. If we have an argument with a processor of services, data services, or an outsourcing company, or a client that they are asking for some activities that were not done, or some prevention that was not done, we need to justify the thing that we have not been doing, because we can say that finally there was not any risk. And giving our own opinion is not going to fly. What you need is to get the data, to get a good methodology, and finally, in any administrative or judicial instance, you will be able to produce a much better evidence, a solid piece of evidence. And finally, we are using these strong quantitative methodologies in order to decide when a due diligence is a non-go, when we're going to reject a merger because it's not worthy, when we're going to reject a vendor. We say, you cannot be a vendor, you cannot be a supplier, you cannot be a data processor for me because the price is not considering the risk of dealing with you. So there are a strong and important and critical decisions in our organizations. And you can decide whether do you want to support those decisions by opinions, by adjectives, or by data. We have a new ISO supporting the ISO 21000 on the principle of risk management that is focused on the legal risks. This is the ISO 21022. And this ISO that was published in May requires to use the best available information in the legal assessment, in the legal risk assessment, following the ISO 21000. And we cannot tell in 2020 that we don't have data. We cannot support this vague and superficial assessment because there is no data. Basically, you will discover that you got more data than you need and you need less data than you think you need, which is absolutely fantastic in order to use these probabilistic tools, in order to use these methodologies to quantify risk. And then it's extremely important that you understand that no tool is going to be better than the inputs that you support, that you feed into. If the data is not good as an input, they will not be better the data as the output. So having the right methodology is the first step. And then you need to focus on the data, whether where is good data in risk and compliance. So there are a lot of data that you can collect internally from your organization. You should be able to produce statistics about paid compensations, penalties, and fines. You should be able to produce statistics about complaints, complaints from clients. What are the clients complaining about? Do we want to reduce the complaints? Which are the trigger for those complaints? There are a lot of processes with these statistics being monitored. Customer service, for instance, which are the expectations for the clients. When we understand compliance as the way that the organization is meeting stakeholders' expectations, whether it's a client, whether it's a regulator, whether it's an employee, whether it's an a candidate for a job, whether it's a visitor, whether it's a neighbor for our premises, in our premises, all these stakeholders will complain. And we can use proper risk management. We can use the data for what they are complaining about in order to shape the ethics and compliance program. We have a lot of statistics about whistleblowing, fraud reports, disputes, claims. We should have good statistics about incidents and near misses for all the regulations, for all the processes, from safe and safety that we want to have accidents here, to facility management. You got data there. You can learn from the previous incidents, and more important, from near misses. Then you also need to book legal contingencies. And you got plenty of documentation, you got plenty of statistics, since it's the accounting system, that which are the contingencies that you are booking into the accounting. You can also get a lot of good data from the culture surveys. What is the risk view of our employees? Whether they think is an ethical risk, whether there is an integrity risk here. So there is a lot of data, and you can understand weak points. For instance, our employees in Angola are concerned about corruption. So definitely, you can go deeper and understand what is happening, in which areas. Then, and how this opinion will jeopardize meeting compliance and legal requirements in Angola in the future. That is the meaning of risk. You are using past information in order to analyze trends, in order for you to avoid biases, blind spots. You can also look for non-compliance findings, observations, in past audits, inspection, and certification. You are receiving a lot of non-compliances with A, B, C, and D. So it means that in the future, if a business objective is a regulation, is a contract, is a concession, is a license, is relying on A, B, C, and D, you are in problem, because you need to identify how are you going to treat that risk. And this is the meaning of using data, understanding the past, understanding vulnerabilities, understanding events that happen, and learn from there. In the last update for the SEC guidelines on how to assess the efficiency of the compliance program, it was an addition talking about how the companies are learning from mistakes. What are we doing in order to learn from different lessons? But not only look at your own organization, look also for the external data. And there are plenty of suppliers of legal databases. And depending on the country, there is a lot of information that is free. And you can understand from these databases how much it was the average fine for this and this and this regulation. And you are getting a lot of data. I'm using those tools, and each day I am surprised by the level of granularity that I am able to understand different scenarios and which will be finally the penalty, the fine, the compensation, the sanction that I will receive in case a risk materializes. Then look for cases that the competitors have. Look for breaches, legal cases, disputes, reputational losses, all these events that happen in your industry, to your competitors. Learn from there. learn from all this information that is public. And then you can also get a lot of sector reports that are expanding the radar for that. So there is good data. You got no excuse to avoid using this data. But in order to change, you need to understand what would be the cost of non-changing. So there is a fact. We in the compliance and legal department in general are using very, very, very few of these tools. We are relying on high-level reviews and assessments and discussions to then deploy a lot of efforts, then to allow a lot of investments that the rationale, the allocation for the rationale was not properly done. Being a good risk manager is critical here. It's critical to finally express, communicate which are the needs for the organization. So there will be a major differentiator in the job market if you're using those tools. You can also create an advantage, a competitive advantage for your organization, your career. If you're offering a service for assessing compliance risk to an organization, and you are saying that this is my approach, green to red, all the other competitors are going to use the same approach. But if you're offering to use data analysis, scientific methodologies, a better approach, finally, you will be able to get better clients, better projects. Then these methodologies will help you to prevent surprises in your career. If you are a better planner, if you are avoiding surprises, if you are using the business data with a good methodology, nothing is going to backfire in you. Each time that you are assessing compliance or legal or fraud risk in your own desk, you are basically owning the risk. It's your word, it's your assessment. But when you are collecting data, when you're using a methodology that is scientifically proven, well, finally, you can demonstrate that you are taking care of your duties or your task. Nobody can say that you are not performing a proper due diligence when you are dealing with risk. And then you are able to influence much better the C-level. If you speak the language of business, that is money, well, they will understand. If you are explaining with data what is needed, they will definitely understand. So don't be afraid of using these methodologies. They are not taking more time, and they are producing a way that business decision makers, the C-level, can see your value. And this is the why. You may care about red, yellow, or red colors, but the business is colorblind. So please talk the language of business. Understand the business goals. Understand the assumptions in planning, and get good data in the legal, in the compliance area to support decisions across your organization. But how? So I promised you in the beginning that I will show you what is under the hood, how these methodologies are working in a way that you can control. I will invite you to explore more, to use more other more tools and models, but it can be done when you already understand how these methodologies, how this tool are working. So let me start from the end. Let me start from Monte Carlo, that this is the methodology that is really producing a better result. What is this methodology about? It's a way that you can calculate the outcome of many scenarios. When we are assessing compliance risk in general in the heat maps, we assume that the risk is only one dot, one bubble, but they are not. Sometimes you are lucky, sometimes you are not, sometimes you are less lucky and not so lucky there. Sometimes the client litigates, sometimes they don't. So when you are only assessing a single scenario, you are missing this volatility. You are missing all the different outcomes. Monte Carlo will help you in order to understand the outcome for at least 10,000 scenarios. Okay, you don't need to calculate them manually. We will see how the tool is working, but the key is that you got a large number that is large enough to understand the whole bunch of outcomes. Then, Monte Carlo, as you can assume, is related to a casino. So it's calculating random values. For each of the random values in the input, we'll calculate what is the outcome for each scenario. We call that a trial. So you basically need to have 10,000 trials, 10,000 different ways that you are playing in the casino to see the outcome. In the large number, you can understand the truth. For one, two, three scenarios, maybe you are lucky or maybe you are unlucky. But for 10,000 scenarios, oh, I guess that finally you can see the whole picture. So that is the meaning. That is the easy way to explain this methodology. And you can do a forecast. The tool will do a forecast for each scenario to finally get an histogram, a way that you can see the whole picture. How many of those scenarios are the top 10%? How many of these scenarios are in the 10 to 20% of the cases, and which will be the loss between which value and to what value? So, as a result for using Monte Carlo simulations, you can calculate, for instance, the value of the reserves, the compliance reserves. You can calculate how much money do you need to get in the insurance coverage. You can establish how much do you need to invest in controlling operations in order to prevent breaches. So you may not be prepared to be ready to deal with 100% of the scenarios in which everything was wrong. But there should be a tolerance. There should be a way that you can be consistent in the way that you are finally accepting a contract, accepting a price, from the legal perspective, from the compliance perspective, to approve a service, to approve a vendor. And that is the way that you can say that you can be prepared to address 90%, 80%, 70% of the scenarios, and you have the capabilities to deal with that. So it's a completely different approach that using the heat maps. Let's go for one example. Let's see how these methodologies are working. Imagine that you need to assess legal risks and compliance risks in a contract for a construction project. They will be the organization is studying to get a big contract to construct a building, and you identified because you got the contractual clauses, you got the regulations, and this is the way that you can start, that you start the identification of risks in legal and compliance. You start from regulations, you start for the contract clauses that have a compliance request. Of course, that you don't need to assess the risk for a clause that is talking about which are the parties. But when there is a clause that requires the organization to do something, there is a chance that the company is unable to perform. And there is a chance that the company will default the contract. So that's why we start from these objectives. The objectives will be the compliance requirement in clauses in contract. They are the compliance requirements in the applicable laws, in the applicable regulations, and also our own values. Fraud, for instance, corruption. Is corruption a risk for me, or is corruption a business accepted strategy? If it is a risk because you want to prevent corruption, definitely there is a risk that you are not preventing corruption or collusion or fraud. So you identify in this case seven different risks that related to this project. You talk to the SMEs, you know the requirements, you know the contract that is there, you know the regulations, and you identify that, for instance, there may be penalties, disputes, compensations because the quality of the work is not good enough. There may be penalties because there are delays in delivering the service. There may be cost overruns, that there is a business plan for this construction project and the business plan has compliance requirement embedded, has assumptions related to compliance and legal requests. And then there may be an overcost in this project because there is fraud and collusion with subcontractors. Kickoff, for instance. And then there may be suspensions of work permits. It's a new project, so you need to get some licenses, and they may be denied, they may be late, there may be a lot of different scenarios in which you are unable to get the proper paperwork and to get the green light from the authorities. There may be some fines in the environmental law that may happen if you're not controlling. There may be some fines because you are breaching the safety regulations. So you identify all these risks, different risks, you understand the contract, you understand the regulation. This is coming back to the risk assessment method steps that we have in the ISO. And you need to quantify, you need to assess the risk. And then you can use the 5-2-5, in this case it's a 4-by-4 heat map, and this is what you will have traditionally. You may discuss with the SMEs that we can make them be the risk owners about the different risks, and finally you get a map, which is kind of unclear about what you should do with the risks that are in red. You should cancel them, or you should terminate them. What are you gonna do? And what is yellow? How do you control them? What it means that delays in the license will be unlikely and medium. It means that to violations in safety regulations is the same that one delayed in the license. So basically, in a good day, this approach is useless. And in a bad day, this approach is dangerous because is influencing bad decision making. So before we go to the tool to explain how they work, it's simplified. I'm not expecting you to use this tool only to understand how this methodology is working. You can add, for instance, an add-on in Excel to deal with Monte Carlo simulations. You can download some templates, but you can only do that if you understand what is happening behind the curtain. So the implicit, the underlying calculations are very important. How we use these methodologies? Well, because we measure the risk for non-compliance in contractual clauses. We start from the contractual requirements. We test the assumptions that we have in a business plan, in a contract that is about to be signed, that you need to approve. And then finally, you write effective provisions and penalties in order to change the decision making by the counterparts. So definitely you can change the clauses. You can sometimes even pay more to assume less liabilities, but for a risk that you can tolerate. Also, when you need to calculate your budget in the compliance area, when you need to deal with the NESICA compliance program, and then you need to assess which is the budget and the starting from criminal offenses, fraud, corruption, insider trading, any legal requirements, any value that the company has, and then you compare the investment and how much are you being exposed to those risks with the current controls as long as they are maturing. So you can compare the efficiency of the compliance program in time, just because you know which were the previous exposure and the current exposure. Then you can calculate how much do you want to invest in data security for impact assessment. The data processing and impact assessment are extremely important right now. And if you're using a good methodology, you will be able to understand cost, understand if there is worth it to deal with a vendor, if there is worth it to make this change in the way that we are dealing with data. And also, very important in concessions, how you are able to establish a proper bidding price that is paying off not only the cost, but also the liabilities, particularly in the legal and compliance area. You are not alone. I am happy to communicate with you and to be able to discuss how you can advance. But let me share an Excel spreadsheet that is showing the rationale for these methodologies. What do we have here? It's a simplified way to see how Monte Carlo is working. Typically, we are assessing one scenario. Some companies are assessing the worst scenario. Many other companies are assessing the most probable scenarios. However, just focusing on one scenario is not good enough. We were discussing that risk is continuous. There are a volatility in risk, of course. And we can think about a best case in which, for instance, the cost of breaching a compliance requirement linked to a risk is not so material, is not so important. And then you can think about a worst case. There are different distributions. Sometimes in compliance we have a binary distribution, so you either make a profit or make a loss, you win or lose, or there are Gaussian distributions, there are log normal distributions, there are different scenarios. But what I'm going to assume here is that you may have a base scenario that is not the average between the worst and the case. So you can think, okay, just in the middle of this scenario, you will lose, if this risk materializes, $90,000. That will be an average here. That will be the base, the best case. That will be how many times, how much this risk will happen if you think that this risk only happens once, is per event. Good. You can also do the same exercise for all the risks. You can deal here with not only money, but also frequencies. You can deal here with days, for instance, if you want to understand some delays. For instance, it's very important when we are talking about recovery time objectives in recovery plans and business continuity plans. You can add any KPI as long as you are adding which will be the impact for different scenarios, and you are adding how much it will cost, finally, you are able to use these methodologies, these quantitative methodologies. Having numbers like 1 to 5 in the qualitative assessment, it doesn't mean that it's a qualitative assessment. It's just the number is linked to an adjective. As long as you are not linking these numbers to adjectives, it's fine. So you are assessing what will be the chances for these scenarios to happen. Remember that we are assuming that now these risks are independent. In practice, this risk may have common sources. So if you have a heavy rain, it may be a risk materializing here and here and here. So there will be different impacts. We are not considering impacts that they are related. So this is for you to understand how these tools work. And we have the different scenarios. The scenarios will be created automatically from random data. We are using here rand functions, that is for randomizing, and is changing each time that you open, close, or update the file. So for the first trial, you assume, the Monte Carlo will assume that there is a 25% chances to happen. It's not the worst and the base, that in these examples are only the fifth percentile. So you are getting the base impact. Depending on the number, here you can see that is lower. So you were lucky. You are not losing $9,000. You are losing only $5,000. Because you were lucky in this scenario for this risk, And they may be risks that they are not materializing. When they, we got, for instance, zero in these permits, you are not expecting this risk to happen. For instance, in the best scenario, 5% of the scenarios, this risk is not materializing. So the tool, the methodology, will calculate 10,000 scenarios. And from these 10,000 scenarios, you have an histogram. This histogram is producing the number of scenarios that falls into a bucket, a bin, according to the distribution. So you can tell, for instance, that 94% of the scenarios are producing a loss that is close to $500,000. And you can tell here that if you got a reserve for it, as you got an insurance, or you got controls dealing with this, mitigating this risk to zero, you can invest $500,000 that makes sense for the risk that you are assuming. So it's critical for you to know which will be the value that you have several chances to succeed if you get a different price and you have a different budget that you allocated for the liabilities that this contract will happen. You cannot do this analysis in a heat map. So that is the message that I wanted to share. And then you can advance with other tools, for instance, installing an add-on in Excel with Monte Carlo simulations that you can go deeper, particularly when you are adding decision trees analysis here. It helps a lot in the decision making, and finally, you are going to be seen as a better advisor, as a better help for the business to support decision making in the way that you can justify which is the corporate defense, which is the precautions, which are the measures that we need to take in order to maximize chances for success. So this is the end of the journey. It's just an introduction to this tool. I am very glad that you are participating in this session. I am very glad that RIS Academy and Alex have organized all this RIS Awareness Week for the second time. Definitely, these ideas should impact our community in RIS and compliance in order to move the maturity of what are we doing further. Thank you so much, and bye.